Welcome to Bethel World Outreach Church. Our values are devotion, diversity, and discipleship. Devotion through honoring God by trusting His Word, praying, and worshiping together. Diversity by embracing God's heart for every nation. And discipleship by helping others follow Jesus. So join us as we're reaching a city to touch the world.
I want to start today's message just as a continuation of last week. And I'm going to continue with this subject matter because you can get something out. That's one thing. To keep something out is quite another. And when I was young, I had a visitation that was demonic. The enemy began to speak to me and almost became an invisible friend. And this invisible friend would tell me that he was good and that God was bad. And the proof that God was bad is that he didn't like this evil spirit that was coming to me. He assassinated God's character all the time, and he elevated his own and say, see, it was subtle, simple distractions and misdirections and deceptions that seduced a young man into a cult behavior, that was laced with truth and demonic cultish mysticism all in one. This is a real palatable way to be seduced by the enemy, to not make you completely get rid of what you believe, but to just bring it into question. And I thought as a child, how could the enemy visit me as a child when I am defenseless, when I am helpless, when I am easily tricked, manipulated, or confused? But then I realized as I got older, and I hope you realize in this lesson, that the power of God's word and the truth works for any age. The deception is to convince you that there's something God can't do and there's something he can do. So here's, I've got to kind of, today I wanted to take a moment, if I could, before we get into our main text, and kind of give you a landscape that you need, or a picture that you might need in order to fight your adversary more effectively. Now, one of the biggest tricks of the enemy is to convince us he doesn't exist. But the world now, according to Gallup, I think 81% people believe there's God. Then it's 56% to believe there's the devil. You know, and then there's 30% to believe in aliens, telekinesis, all this stuff. So there seems to be a part of us that understands there's an immaterial world that is out there, but people don't interact with the immaterial world very often. It's almost this thing in the back of your mind that you know exists. You visit it at moments because you have to, but you don't live being aware that what's more real, the things in this room that we can see or the things in this room that we cannot see. Now, the reality is your instincts want to tell you what you can see, but everything that you can see came from an unseen place. So why is this a fundamental truth from the beginning of the world, when man had a interaction with physical and spiritual things all at the same time? And yet the thing we want to do now is be more naturally minded than spiritually minded. But to be more like Christ, you got to take on a spiritual mindset. And so We have enemies and adversaries against us. The Bible says, I don't have time to go through the scriptures, but if you want to know more about this and you want to get rocked in a real tangible way, come on Wednesday nights. I'll be teaching about the Holy Ghost, the power, the spirit realm. So I want you, yeah, I know, but you know, just might as well start, you know, get yourself tuned up with the prayer meeting that's coming up, and then get yourself ready for your own individual shot. Get excited. It's what, I mean, yeah. Because something you've been held out of that has great benefit is coming to you. Now, so there's a spirit of the world that the Bible says we should not give into it. There is a spirit. It says, in fact, it says, believe not every spirit, but test the spirit to figure out whether it's of God or not. So there is a spirit world. You can't believe every spirit. You've got to put the spirits to the test. So then there's some type of fight. Then he says there's a spirit of the world. There's a spirit of the enemy. There's not a spirit of your flesh, but there's a carnal mind, which is trying to pull you down to earthly base things. The carnal mind simply is, if you need a definition, it's your mind or your soul man working independent of God's direction. That's all it is, just to help you. You're fighting all that stuff. He said, but no, he said, and you know what he calls this? This is the spirit of Antichrist. Any spirit that calls Christ accursed, any spirit that doesn't trust Jesus is Antichrist. It's an anti-spirit. It is tapping into something. Anything that tells you that Jesus is bad. These are the ABCs and 1-2-3s and basic fundamentals of spiritual living that every child needs to know and every adult needs to know, because God doesn't want you ignorant of what he's provided for you. Then the Bible says we need to cleanse ourselves of all filthiness of the flesh and of the spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God. There is work to be done. The Bible says in Isaiah, the spirit of the Lord is on me. In Luke, Jesus reads the book and said, the spirit of the Lord is on me. He's anointed me to heal the sick, to deliver, to preach to you the acceptable year of our Lord. Jesus is waging a spiritual war. And then he's telling you the battle is not against flesh and blood, but against spiritual wickedness, rulers of darkness, powers of this world. It's against evil, not against people. So whenever the enemy can get us to focus on the natural and avoid focusing on what's going on in the spiritual, he is keeping us out of the fight instead of in the fight. But I'm trying to get you into the fight. In fact, the Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are mighty through God to the pulling down of stronghold. In other words, they are spiritual weapons you've been given. He didn't give you a mallet, an axe, or a bazooka, or something to take out human beings. He gave you the power to, through the sword of the spirit, through the spirit of the Lord, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the feet ready with the gospel of peace. He gave you all this weaponry to defend and to advance kingdom spiritual principles. I'm just setting it up. We're not into the lesson yet. Okay? So you got to understand this. Here's three things to help you understand. You come on Bible study and I explain it more. I'm just going to preach it to you. I'll teach it to you if you come on Wednesday night. You need to come on Wednesday night. You do not have enough. You do not have enough. You do not have enough information. You do not have enough understanding of what's going on not to come on Wednesday night. That's just when we teach you. So man is a spirit. He possesses a soul. He lives in a body. I'm a trichotomist, spirit, soul, and body. There are dichotomists who think spirit and soul are one. For the purposes of this conversation, we're trichotomists. Okay, does this help you out? So the Bible says, that's when he says, when you sin, the Bible says the wages of sin is death. The free gift of God is eternal life. But when Adam and Eve sinned, did their life on earth get extinguished? No, they got an expiration date. And their connection with God died. It was a spiritual death. That's why he says when you get born again, he said that was just born of flesh is flesh. That was, this is John 3:3. That was just born of spirit is spirit. And he says that your spirit is a part of you that's just like him. Your spirit is a part of you that's invested with God's spirit. You get the endowment of the spirit. This is where you get invested eternal life. And you're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the spirit. So then he gives you this gift of faith where you can take things out of the spirit and pull it into the natural. Come on Wednesday, I'll help you explain how to do that. Your soul is your intellect, will, and emotions. So as your spirit man, it's a part of you that already got saved, got eternal life. The way you think, which is your intellect, will, and emotions, is being trained to think like God. You're being transformed by the, according to Romans 12, you're being transformed by the renewing of your mind that you might prove what is that good, acceptable, perfect will of God. This is the part of you that's trying to start acting right. And when you don't act right, it's the carnal mind absence, the direction of the Holy Spirit. And that's called the flesh. And it is opposed to the spirit. Your spirit man is getting information from God, always telling you what God wants. And your flesh is always informed by what you want or what the devil tempts you to want. And these two are odds with one another. That's the part of you that's in the process of being saved when it aligns through the sanctification process. We had the mind of Christ. This is where you're fighting at. Okay? Your body, according to 1 Corinthians 15, is waiting to be saved. In other words, it's got a promise, but that promise ain't fully fulfilled. How you know? This body dying. This body is decaying. It's aging. Just look at Dave. He's getting gray hairs by the moment. He is losing them. They're just, Dave, do you want to show the people? No, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay. Just start coloring your beard like me and then you'll be all right. Now, so that's the part of you that's waiting. When this mortality will put on immortality, when this natural will put on supernatural, when you see him, you'll be transformed to be like him. You'll get that body to fall. Remember they said, old saying, you'll fall down and you won't get hurt. You won't be hungry anymore, but you can eat, you know, all that stuff. That's fun. So saved spirit, being saved, soul, waiting to be saved, your body. And all this while you're waging war. The war is happening on your mind because your mind dictates what your body. You can't move your arm without your brain saying do it. So where is this fight? It's not against your spouse.
Say that, preacher. Say that.
It's not against your employer. It's not against the nation, the president. So you bypass the real war, the real fight, and the real power, and you think the I'm not telling you not to vote, but don't think that the power is in your vote and then you don't have no power on your knees. Yes, vote, but dictate, you know. So Matthew 12, I'm just gonna give you this. Let's go to Matthew 12. Then a demon-oppressed man who was blind and mute was brought to him, and he healed him so that the man spoke and saw. Jesus said that it was a spiritual reason that the man couldn't speak or see. It wasn't just hereditary. It wasn't just a sickness. It wasn't just a disease. While there can be hereditary things, there can be sicknesses, there can be diseases that are not demonically inspired, but there are things that are demonically inspired. And one of the things the devil comes to do is to hold your mouth or to prevent you from seeing. But when Jesus comes in, he releases your mouth and he releases you to see, because these are tools he's going to use in you. Jesus can deliver from every and all types of oppression. But notice, this wasn't one that can be medically solved. This wasn't about your diet. This was a spiritual attack, and it has a spiritual solution if you understand where the war is and where the fight is and what you can actually do or not do. And then, okay, now I'm going to say this. So I don't know if you've ever had that moment where you're laying in your bed. I don't know if you've experienced it, but I'm going to describe it. My son just described, one of my sons, Jackson, asked me, could I share this? He said, yeah, he described that sometimes, and this happened to me too. Does it matter your age? The enemy will come in and figure out if you're spiritually aware or not. And the way he'll test it is he'll immobilize you. All of a sudden, you feel like, okay. And it's subtle at first, just a little. Training you to respond to him spiritually. Immobilizing. You start feeling, I can't move, I can't breathe, I can't think, I can't move, what's wrong? The other one he does is he gets you to dangerous circumstances. And right when you're in a dangerous circumstance, he says, jump. He said, move. I wonder what would happen if you drink. I wonder what would happen if you smoke. It's all a spiritual attack. But you got to know how to solve it. This is how he works. So you got to know where the war is raging. You got to know what's going to come against you. And just to give you the cheat sheet answer, the answer is always the same. Those who call on him, they're saved out of every distress. Those that call on him. So if you don't know what to do, if you don't understand demonology, if you don't understand the spirit, know one thing. There is a spirit of God that's available at the moment you call on him. Sometimes all you got to do is think his name and you'll be able to say it. Jesus. But it's a clue of you needing to make an adjustment with your spiritual education so that you're not available for this. Because I think, contrary to popular opinion, God is not removing the devil, he's using the devil. He's not there as an occupant, but a visitor. He's there by permission. Hey, Satan, what you doing? Going to and fro? Up and down the earth? They're looking for some people. The Bible said the enemy is looking for whom he may devour. Seeing who not spiritually aware. See who not paying attention. See who got doors and gates open. Windows open. I'm just creeping in and out of places. Going in and out of people's lives. Robbing them. Stealing from them. That's what I'm doing, Lord. What you got going on today? He said, well, hey, Satan, buddy. What you thinking about Job? Oh, well, don't mess with him. All of us understand you really like him. You got this like hedge of protection around him. It's not worth it to get cast out or sent to the lake early. We know our limits and our boundaries, Lord. We respect you, you know. He said, well, you know what? What if I do something for you so you can fulfill your purpose? What if I move the hedge from Job and then you can tell you can do anything to him except take his life? So now Job gets sick. He loses things. Now, but is this a physical attack or a spiritual attack that's manifesting itself in physical ways? It's spiritual. It cannot be solved in the flesh. Okay, it cannot be solved in the flesh. Consider it. I'm just going over here because I don't want to forget this one scripture to just clue into my spirit. See, when you, I got lots of time. When you don't understand this, you don't understand this statement. Paul said, when I will to do good, evil always present. And the thing I don't want to do with my spirit is if everything I find myself doing in my flesh, who shall deliver me from this body of death? I thank God that my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is my only hope. If you think self-discipline is going to do it, it's not. If you think the power of positive thinking is going to do it, it's just going to curb your appetite. You have to have empowered speech, the power of the word, the power of his spirit. You need spiritual weapons to solve natural problems. Now, let me tell you, there's a use of the name and there's an abuse of the name. In Acts 19, you know, there was some young Jewish wannabe exorcists. They saw exorcists, so they went over to seven sons of Sceva. Bible say, y'all just look that story up later. The Bible say, they went over to an old fella and they say, y'all come out in Jesus' name. That's the right name. But potentially the wrong people. So he calls a name. They all come out. And the spirit spoke back to him. Say, Paul, I know him. He got a relationship with God. And Jesus, we know him. That's definitely the Son of God. But who are you telling me to get out the house? The Bible said, and the man, the spirit was in the man, leaped on them seven boys, beat them, scripture says, and ripped all their clothes off, and they ran out naked and beaten. The name cannot be taken in vain. The name is not a curse word. The name is not something that is used for your own particular benefit. It is not empowered that way. It is a name that is used by faith and belief and relationship. So when you say, you know, it's all in your name, in the name of Jesus, I want you to do this or that. The power comes from authentic relationship that is produced by belief. Because you call them and the devil will say, you don't believe what you're saying. See, they only borrowed the name. And they used the name like an incantation or a spell. Jesus. Like Simon the sorcerer. He was just adding Jesus' name to a list of stuff that he did. In verse 23, and all the people saw and were amazed and said, can this be the Son of David? Is this the guy to whom we've been waiting on? This guy ultimate power? But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, it's only Beelzebub, the prince of demons, that the man cast out demons. Knowing their thoughts, he said, every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and no city or house divided can stand. If Satan cast out Satan, he has divided himself. How then will his kingdom stand? And if I cast out demons by Beelzebub, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore, they will be your judges. You just don't want to be having a wrong conversation with Jesus. He will turn that thing around on you. He'll say, you think I got a devil? What you got? You don't even make sense. In other words, if Satan was so confused, he might sell confusion, but he's not confused. He may sow discord, but he has order. He has strategy. Okay? He has power. But you can see where he is working if you see division. I'm going to prove this to you. Now, the Bible says in Romans 16, 17, y'all don't have that scripture in the back, so you can put it in your notes. Paul warns, I urge you, brethren and sisters, not to watch out for those who cause division and put obstacles in your way that are contrary to the teachings you have learned. Keep away from them. So, your friends outside of church that have a divisive message for our nation, got to let them go. Because if you stay under their spiritual poison, you will get your own well poisoned. You become what you behold. You can become what you ingest if you listen to it too long. You'll be real. Well, you know, that is true. No, he is the spirit of truth. Yeah, that's right what they say. You don't know what's right. No man knows, knows a man say the spirit is in him. Even so, no man knows God to say the spirit is in him. You don't know people's heart. The Bible says man looks on the outside, God looks at the heart. Stop speaking as if you got spiritual knowledge of everything. Well, I know that's the right person. Do you? Tell me that God showed you something and you're doing what God wanted you to do. I'm not going to come against that. But don't try to make a nonsensical world make sense. It is riddled with sin and brokenness, and it's under a demonic system that I am above. I'm an alien here. I'm just an ambassador. My citizenship is in heaven. I'm a passerby. I'm not limited to my U.S. passport. I got heaven's passport. That means I go where I want, where I want. And if you stop me, it's his will or his choice for somebody else's benefit. And that's it. Paul urged you, 1 Corinthians 1:10, he said that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind, the same judgment, you speak the same thing. So you're combating that spiritual division with spiritual unity. You see, your attacker and his strategy to get you is clear, but I want you to know it fails.
Hallelujah.
It fails. Yes. Matthew 12, if you go to the 28th verse, says, but if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. How can someone enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man? Then indeed he may plunder his house. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather scatters. So we know about, there's three accounts of this in the Gospels. And if we put all these accounts together, we know that the house is us. The strong man is Satan. The stronger man is Jesus. The one that is stronger binds him. You don't bind him. I'm going to say this again. The one who is stronger binds him. You don't bind him. You speak what he spoke. God, whatever's been bound already in heaven, let it be bound on earth. You're not acting as if you have the same spiritual acclimate as the things that you are fighting against. You're trusting in God, the stronger one, to come in and solve your problem. You can't fight a demon. This idea that people are chasing demons so they can cast them out, you know, and hyper-focus. There's no scripture that tells you to hyper-focus on the devil. Then you want to have a service with an hour-long conversation with one spirit. Where is that in the book? Get that spirit out your life and don't play with stuff that's strong like that. His kingdom has power. 1 Corinthians 4 and 20 says, but I will come to you soon if the Lord wills, and I will find out not the talk of those arrogant people, but their power. For the kingdom of God does not consist in talk, but in power. It's an everlasting, powerful kingdom. The Bible says in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of God. It's the power of God. The gospel itself is power. Stop leaning on something else. Stop trusting in something else. Stop thinking that church should give you something more than the gospel. The gospel has to lead the way. That's the truth about who Jesus is. If you want to avoid the lie, if you want to avoid the seduction of the enemy, you better lead with the gospel. And stop thinking it's just a way and start knowing it's the way. Don't open to the gospel and everything else. Well, how about these people? They're going to make it too. How about these people? They're going to make it too. Nobody is going to make it without the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Spirit has power. You should have power when you're baptized in the Spirit. Acts 1:8. The Spirit in Acts 1:5 and 1:8 says you should receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Now the enemy has power, and his power is in seduction. He seduced the children of Israel in Rome in Revelations 2:14. Watch how the enemy's power works. This is a powerful understanding of how the spirit world works. But I have a few things against you. You and some of you who hold the teachings of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the sons of Israel so that they may not eat food sacrificed to, so they can eat food sacrificed to idols and practice sexual immorality. Look, I'm telling you that the devil doesn't have a new play. His first sin around food. It's all become some type of cultist activity about behaviors around food, and then liberality when it comes to sexual immorality. Everything can go. Anything can go. If you're in any level of sexual immorality, in any impurity like that, you are under a spiritual and a demonic attack. This is much more than a natural craving. This is, you are being trained by a demonic force to love or want something that is inordinate, that is unnatural. In the King James, it calls it inordinate or unnatural affections. You shouldn't have affections for certain things. That's been a demonic here's this, a stronghold. A stronghold is a demonically induced thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God that you believe, and it brings you into captivity. A stronghold is a demonically induced thought that exalts itself against the knowledge of God that you believe, and it brings you into captivity. We can bind him in Jesus' name. We have power over him in Jesus' name. If you want the secret to defeating him, James 4:7 gives you the number one secret to defeating the enemy. He says, submit yourself therefore to God. Submit to God. You have no chance of defeating spiritual weaponry if you do not submit to God. If you hold on to anger, you're not submitted to God. If you hold on to bitterness, you're not submitted to God. If you hold on to lust, you are not submitted to God. But when you willingly yield control to the Lord, you have a power that you wouldn't ordinarily have. It is a spiritual power. And then the next verse says you will resist the devil and he will flee from you. This word resist means to just stand. You don't have to stand and just stand on the truth, stand in the truth. Don't be intimidated. Don't be in any level of fear. The Bible says when he sees you submitted to God and standing on the word and the will of God, the Bible says he will run away from you afraid. So I'm here to announce to you, the enemy does have power, but God has given you more power, but your power is not activated till you submit to him. Then you can resist him. Oh, Jesus. Let me get this last point. And when verse 43, and when an unclean spirit has gone out of a person, it passes through waterless places seeking rest. So whatever we know, when spirits come out of people, it's uncomfortable for them. We don't understand it all, but it's just uncomfortable. So they can't take that discomfort. So what do? So they look for rest. And if they can't find any other place to go, like to the pigs, I couldn't find any place to go. What's their next choice? Then I will return to my house. Who's the house? We are. He gonna return to the house. And when he comes to the house, he finds the house empty, swept, put in order. That sounds good. Last week you got delivered and everything was right. But the fight didn't end, and it wasn't a natural fight, it was a spiritual one. Then he goes and brings with him seven other spirits more evil than itself, and they enter and dwell there, and the last state of the person is worse than the first. So also will it be in an evil generation. That would be us. Getting the devil out is one thing. Keeping him out is another. What are you going to do to keep him out? I'm ending the message with this. You can stand to your feet. Here's what you do to keep him out. I gave you seven things last week. I don't have time to go through those, but here's Here's a new thing. The house was empty, clean, and swept, but the Bible didn't say it was filled. You need to stay filled. Filled with the Spirit. The first thing in Exodus 3:34, the Lord passed in front of Moses and called out, Yahweh, the Lord, the God of compassion and mercy. I am slow to anger and filled with unfailing love and faithfulness. You need to be filled with God. And when you're filled with God, you'll be filled with love. Psalm 103:5 says, He fills my life with good things. My youth is renewed like the eagle. He fills you with good things. If it's something bad in your life, the blessings of the Lord make rich and add no sorrow. Romans 15:13, may the God of all hope fill you with joy and peace in believing that by the power of God, He fills you with joy and peace. The Bible says that you need to, in Ephesians 5:18, don't be drunk with wine where it's debauchery, but be being filled with the Spirit. The Bible says, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, they'll be filled. Meditate on the word day and the night. You're going to be full of the word. What you got to do? Keep your house full. Keep your house full. You don't fear the devil, but you understand there's a war. So when did this young boy visited by the devil, visited with night terrors, riddled with fear, having to go to counselors, walking through the house in the middle of the night, stabbing the darkness, trembled no matter my size, thoughts of somebody murdering me and doing something to me. Now it produced this alter ego maniac. So you become what you're trying to run from. How are these people produced? Because they've been under a spiritual attack. The next generation needs us to know how to fight. And you can get rid of every enemy by announcing to them through Jesus' name they gotta go. Whether you're not saved and you're possessed, or whether you're saved and you're oppressed, you're still being brought under the control of something that's not God. You can get rid of it. I'm gonna pray that prayer. But this message is about how you maintain that. Dixon, this is how you maintain it. This is how you do it. The heritage of that church is spiritual revival. Live in it. Take advantage of it. Now listen to me. We're going to go out today being filled. I'm going to pray deliverance prayer again. But remember, deliverance can happen in a moment. You start dismissing the devil. The only time deliverance take a long time is when you, the host, are fighting it. Well, I don't know. I'm going to hold on to that. You're still thinking about stuff. No, you get free. Remember, don't get nervous if somebody yelling out or somebody yawning or crying or something like that. That's just their version of getting free. That's not even something you have to repeat. Well, I don't want it to come out. Well, don't. Just say, come out. Get off me. But don't just get clean. Get filled. Raise your hands up in this room. I'm going to pray for you. Ministry team, you can come down while I'm praying. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come quench this thirsting in my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, I lift it up and make me whole. Lord, I take authority in your name over every satanic and demonic attack over this congregation or their families. Wherever the enemy is hiding or speaking, I rebuke and call him out. Whether I call him by name or by activity, he has to go. God, every oppressive spirit has to go. Every possessive spirit has to go. Those that need to be saved, they call on your name. Just even while you're having your hands up, just call on the name of Jesus under your breath. Call on the name of Jesus under your breath. Lord, I'm asking now. You said all we had to do to receive is ask, seek, and knock. We're asking for you to fill us. We're asking you to fill us. Don't let anger control us. Let us be filled. Don't let anything control us except your Spirit. Let us be filled. Fill us to overflowing, Lord. Fill us to overflowing, Lord. Fill us to overflowing, Lord. Tell them to fill you. Tell them to fill you. Tell them to fill you. Tell them to fill you.